The use of Cartesian coordinates, as we've been following so far, is not always the most convenient choice of coordinate systems, and especially if you have bodies that have symmetries that are related to other types of coordinate systems. For instance, if you have circular bodies, then polar coordinates tend to be kind of nice, and if you have spherical bodies, then spherical coordinates tend to be kind of nice ways of representing things. So I just want to look real quickly as what happens if you have if you decide to use one of these other coordinate systems. So let's take a look at the case of polar coordinates. So if I use polar coordinates, then if I have a point that I want to locate, I could obviously locate it with respect to its x, y, z components, but not necessarily. I could also relate it by its polar coordinates. So for instance, its angle with respect to the x-axis, its radial distance from the origin in the xy plane, and its distance above or below the xy plane by z. And so r, the radial distance, is just equal to the square root of x squared y squared, where x and y are the coordinates in the Cartesian case. And theta is equal to the arctangent of y over x. And you can also flip the coordinates around. X is equal to r cosine theta and y equals r sine theta. So these are standard polar coordinates. Now, associated with polar coordinates are also the tangent vectors in the coordinate direction. So there's er, so which points in the radial direction, e theta, which points in the theta direction, and e z, which points in the z direction. And the thing that makes polar coordinates, along with any curvilinear coordinates, a little bit more difficult is the fact that when you go from one point to another, the actual physical direction in which the unit vectors points changes. Cartesian coordinates are nice because ex, no matter what point in space you're looking at, points in the same general direction. But er always points out radially from the origin, so as you swing around the origin, ER points in different directions. But you can still define stresses with respect to these coordinate systems, and sometimes it's a very convenient thing to do. So suppose I have a cylindrical body and I make a section cut in this body, so I'll just slice it horizontally here. And let me redraw that figure over here on the side and then go ahead and examine one point here. If I look at that point there, then if I want to talk about the stress components, I could talk about the normal stress component. That would be sigma zz, so section cut normal is in the z direction, and then I talk about the force per unit area in the z direction. Again, at this point I can talk about the force per unit area in the r direction. That's going to be sigma zr, so that's a shear stress, and I can talk about the force per unit area in the theta direction, or sometimes known as the hoop direction. That'll be sigma z theta. So now when I go to different points, though, so if I look at a point over here, sigma zr is going to point in this direction over here, and sigma z theta will point in this direction, so that's parallel to the plane, and sigma zz will point in this direction. So in the polar case, you have to be a little bit careful about specifying what point you're actually looking at, because the directions, the coordinate directions, are changing from point to point. But you can still talk about forces per unit area in different directions, in this case defined by the polar directions r and theta and z. The pictorial convention for the stresses, let's say we're dealing with a 2D case, so then we'd have sigma rr. They're drawn on top of the polar unit area as opposed to the little square, but you'll have sigma rr. So normal stress in the radial direction on a section cut here whose normal is also in the radial direction. And then there's a shear stress on that, sigma r theta. So it's a stress or force per unit area on a section cut with normal in the r direction, but the force is in the tangential direction. And then we can have sigma theta theta. So that's the normal stress on a section cut whose normal is in the theta direction. So that's e theta there. And there can be a shear on this plane. That would be sigma theta r. That's force per unit area on a section cut in the theta direction, but the force is in the radial direction. So this is the pictorial representation of stresses in polar coordinates. Just as in the Cartesian case, the shears are going to be equal by moment equilibrium, so sigma r theta will equal sigma theta r. We always have this situation of the off diagonals equal to each other, and symmetry of the stress tensor when we're working with orthogonal coordinate systems, and the polar coordinate system is orthogonal. The expressions for force equilibrium now will be force equilibrium in the r direction and force equilibrium in the theta direction. They're a little bit more complicated than the Cartesian cases, but one can derive them in a similar fashion as to the Cartesian cases. And you can do the exact same thing with other common coordinate systems. The spherical coordinate system is the other most common coordinate system for dealing with curvilinear coordinates.